Around the world, artists are using digital technology to speak their mind. These artists show us that a physical studio is not needed, using the virtual world to question the reality we live in. As part of Power Play, an exhibition championing the African digital art scene, we will explore how these artists create. These are some of their desktops.
I'm Vincent Besaidenhout, and I'm an artist from South Africa. I work a lot with video and photography, kind of delving into a lot of political issues in South Africa, but also further afield, kind of investigate issues around power and history. I started off in a fairly traditional photographic background. But at the same time, I've always been really interested simply in the medium itself, in how photography changes, in how technology changes it. Because the fact is that photography is inextricably linked to technology and the changes in technology. I've always just been interested in how photography is used in different ways. And I've kind of taken that further into how do you use images beyond the print? How do photographs function within video? But I think because of my very early interest, which are still there in terms of documentary photography, I'm still interested in how images can function in terms of reflecting on society or society change. I kind of embraced the internet from a very early start. I think the problem growing up in South Africa was that the internet was always quite bad in the beginning stages. We didn't have the same kind of access to a lot of photography books, for instance, or art books or art museums the same way you would have in Europe or the States. So because of that, you know, most South Africans would learn about art, you know, either through books in the library or online. I've always looked at an insane amount of images, and I still really do. The internet allows for that. It allows to look at as many images as quickly as I can. Using the internet to look at images has always been a big part of what I do. And at the same time, kind of using digital photography, just you know, it just kind of happened. Having said that, I still use film as well. I will work with whatever tools I need to work with. Bodies of work that's old school, large format photography, and then I have work that's literally just screen grabs on my laptop. I will start looking at weird shit, and Instagram will just keep on suggesting more and more of that until my whole feed kind of turns into that. And then I might switch it up and start looking at something else, and Instagram will completely change my feed into something else. Yeah, so with JSOC pics, you know, I noticed these images that military personnel were posting, all kind of fans of military personnel were posting. And I just found it kind of fascinating to kind of glorify these individuals, but at the same time, wanting to obscure their identity. I kind of started looking at that. Maybe there's two elements. The one element is spending time in the States, just being more aware of the military-industrial complex here, how prevalent it is. With my previous body of work called Fail Deadly, I had dealt quite a lot with redaction. What I ran into in researching that project was so much information has been hidden away or completely redacted. So because I was still in that mindset, you know, I started noticing these images. You notice the ways people censor these images. And I found that process fascinating as well. So it kind of, I mean, that's kind of one example. You know, it's, I'll notice something, you know, just in my daily use of the internet, and then it will kind of develop from there. I'm not a traditional studio artist. My studio is either going out to a location or it's my computer. Those are the two environments I work in. And I work in those two environments at the same time. You know, I might go out to some location, but eventually whatever I did at that location will be transferred to my computer. I might use my computer to identify a location, then go to the location, record whatever I need to record, and then that goes back onto my computer. And then it might again transfer into the real world in terms of an object. I would not want to sit in a studio with a canvas or a piece of clay or anything like that. And it's a very fast process. You know, you're gathering all of this stuff, but then you've got to hone it into one little thing. I kind of created this Instagram feed. Various special forces soldiers with their faces redacted. I eventually had this huge library of images. And I was kind of thinking, so what can I do with these images? And I started printing some of them out. I have thousands of prints of these guys, which might, I don't know, if somebody came across it, it might, I don't know what they'd think about. I wanted to see if I guess, what would my response be to these images? That's what I was thinking about. These images and these individuals are inextricably linked to commerce. What I was seeing on Instagram was people who were proud of a certain military culture. They wanted to show it off, but there was also a sense of shame. There's also a sense of secrecy. We want to show these images, but at the same time, we don't want to be identified. I kind of felt that one of the best ways that I could possibly deal with these images would actually be to appropriate them for myself, to take it for myself so I can almost take power away from it, and then to reproduce it in really the most arbitrary, cheap, crass commercial way. How using the images on coffee mugs, using the images on cheap pillows. So, I mean, of course, these are small resolution Instagram images. So at the moment they're transferred to bigger objects and using that process, the quality is terrible. and that's what I really wanted. I wanted the objects to seem very cheap, very handmade. I guess to some extent, there's a certain humorous element to it as well. But I wanted to use that to kind of disarm these images. I've got thousands and thousands of these images. It really becomes interesting in volume. Just this image that I have on the screen right now, the person who ever redacted it used the smudge tool. It's such an interesting choice. You know, oftentimes the blur tool will be used. The most obviously known one would be kind of the black circle. That's one that most people will use. Painting with a complementary color, very very thought provoking. And I mean, those are kind of I kind of became interested in the different forms of redaction. The redaction will go beyond the face. It might go to a military unit, a name on a badge, which, I mean, that's kind of understandable. That's a great image. That's one of my favorites, actually. You can actually go on my website and buy these products. I don't make them myself. I basically have it made through kind of the cheapest companies that I can find. So here you have a lovely, lovely flower pattern that you can kind of use. And the main reason I wanted it in this form is I wanted these to be these kind of cheap consumer products. I think that's kind of, again, the most important aspect of just being able to reduce these images to this comical element. Yeah, so this is one of the objects in its made form. US soldier with an American badge. It says "Fuck Al Qaeda." I mean, who wouldn't want this kind of in their parents' bedroom or something like that? So yeah, so these objects, I'm definitely not limited in terms of how I want to use it. I would literally transfer these images to any object. I've used aerial photography as well. What I've sometimes done is I have appropriated aerial footage from other applications. So for instance, in quite a few of my projects, I've used aerial photography from South Africa. So in South Africa, there's a department called the Department of Land Affairs. They have aerial photographs of every square meter of the country. And I have been able to access that and to use those images to make work. So for instance, this image that I have here, this is it's kind of multiple images stitched together of a road. That is a road running through the Kalahari Desert. That's the road that leads to a ballistic bombing range where South Africa the test shafts to test the equipment. So I kind of accessed this footage in their archives in order to trace a path. In the project's separate amenities, I used Google Maps extensively to actually identify locations. This is an image, it's stitched together 24 different aerial images. It's actually quite large. So this is an area, so this is outside of Cape Town where I lived for a long time, and I still spend a lot of time there. I still make work there. And a lot of the work that I made there was right on that coastline. If you look at the False Bay coastline there, this coastline, right here. Locations which, you know, like very few people would actually visit all through the year. Although these specific locations I used quite a lot. And I would identify it and simply go there without really knowing what I would find, except for what I saw online on a map. I was actually born in Bloemfontein, South Africa, which is right there. It's kind of in the middle of the country. It's a small Afrikaans, fairly conservative city. You know, if I have to look back at it now, that kind of had a major influence on the direction my work was gone. In terms of understanding my own background as a white Afrikaans South African, having grown up in that environment and to a large extent having to reject a lot of culture that I grew up in and some of the people that I was surrounded with, that kind of had a profound influence on the direction my own work. Using South African history, issues around power, to kind of understand both the country and myself. Digital art within art schools in South Africa are kind of non-existent. There's very little in terms of a really thorough structured program within art schools in South Africa. There are things being done. Of course, they're working with limited resources compared to other countries. So, you know, there is, of course, the financial aspect to it. There is the fact that a lot of kids in South Africa don't have Wi-Fi at home. It kind of feeds into larger socioeconomic issues. I think there is also just in general, the South African art world perhaps being a little dismissive of some of these trends. Having said that, if you look at some of the galleries, there's definitely, you know, there are artists who are making very interesting digital-based works at some prominent galleries. I think because of how an obscure medium it is, some interesting things have come out of it. South Africans using their own cultural language combined with digital tools. I think some of the work that's coming from, we're not just South Africa, but Southern Africa and even the whole continent, there's something that's fairly unique about it in a way. The quality of the work in some cases are very, very good. Despite the challenges, there's really exciting work being made. Here I am in a research folder that I have. I actually don't know what's in here, but let's look at it. This was a crop that I made out of a press image. I can't remember the exact situation it was. I think people kind of like flocking towards some dictator just loved. And within the crowd, I just kind of saw this little frame that I cropped. And I just really loved it because it just kind of felt like some kind of Renaissance painting. There's a lot of reading of various things. It's really too much to even go through. And I should be throwing this stuff away. It's kind of like an ongoing thing where I'm always busy reading something. For a long time, I was working with a lot of redacted documents. I was always kind of looking at redacted documents and how they function. And I have a lot of documentation that I've gotten from various sources, you know, the CIA and the FBI through the Freedom of Information Act. I delve into quite a lot of archives. This is a statue that exists in the town where I grew up in Bloemfontein, South Africa. The title is in Afrikaans. It's Die Bitter Einde. And that referred to during the Anglo-Boer War with England. These were kind of the last Boer soldiers who refused to give up. And you can see the starving horse that it's sitting on. But of course, a lot of controversy around that. And I've wanted to remake the statue using black paper because it's kind of almost like a redacted statue in a way. And then I would collect different visual references regarding those things.
I would always have little bits of video footage and things. This is a super racist Afrikaner organization in South Africa, kind of showing security camera footage of guys breaking in, things like that. So what I really loved about this was how the light from the camera overexposes the person the closer they get to the camera. Here they become completely blown out. I guess this kind of refers back to me looking at these little anomalies within photography. So this is actually just a frame to check focus and color, right? So, and then there's images like this, which is the end of frame, right? So that's actually an image taken on the moon, but it's the last frame in the clip. So there's the piece of tape that's holding the film to the spool is kind of still in it. And, you know, it's things like that. So I like the little accidents that always happens with photography. So I actually have, as far as I know, I have the largest collection of documents regarding South Africa's secret weapons program that exists. I have collected all of it. But having said that, there is nothing new in there. There's nothing that's revealed because all the really important things have been redacted. I would simply exhibit the documentation. I was accessing all this information, which essentially meant nothing. The only way I could really use it was to show that. What's really funny is, you know, this idea of a photograph where you want to show the photograph, but you don't want to show everything in the photograph. And the color that would most obscure anything is black. You know, it's as simple as that. At the same time, I've been extremely wary of it because I don't want it to be too easy of a tool. I also don't necessarily like limiting myself to specific techniques. You know, it just kind of keeps popping up for some reason. And I think it's because, you know, it's without people realizing it, this void is kind of, it's so much a part of imagery. It's so much a part of what we do and how we perceive the world. Everyone follows their own path, I guess. Share your work, share your expertise, share your skills. Because really, it's artists standing together and being one group that will kind of push all of this forward. Because the art world is, you know, the art world has been turned into a ruthless business like all other businesses, where it's this cutthroat competition, and it's really the one place where it shouldn't be. I'm always kind of examining what's happening online, the latest kind of little glitches in the matrix that's coming up. I'm always keeping my eye on that, so I'm kind of interested in the future to make a lot of work really quickly, kind of have small bodies of work that just kind of happens by itself. You know, and then combine that with more long-term projects. That's where I am at the moment.